You know, it's been a very long time since I've get to say welcome everybody to our Join Dota live stream coming to you from our Berlin studio. That's right, we're finally back from Seattle, so I can say welcome to everybody who's tuning in right now over here on our Zubu live channel, who's going to be tuning into our next streams coming up as well over on Join Dota Red that's coming up on Wednesday and Thursday, and of course for everyone who's watching on our Join Dota YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/joindota, not to be confused with Join Dota Plus, where we put all our shows and all our TI4 content also ended up. Let's get ourselves inside the game. For those people out there that are wondering, what the hell is Toby One doing today? Well, I have an answer for you. I have a big answer for you. One, I'm battling the flu. Yeah! Oh, that's right. That's right. Nothing to keep a good caster down apart from a throat cold. And the other thing we're doing is the MSI Beta competition. Now, the MSI Beta competition is still in its very infant stages as far as the competition goes. We're doing the open qualifiers for each of the regions. Now, this region is the APAC. This has Korea. This has, I believe, Japan. The team we're casting right now, Team Kirby's, is actually from Japan. And Pretty Donut is, in fact, from Korea. Now, we have a couple of other teams which are also... Tide Hunter. As I'm realizing they're going through their bands pretty quickly, but it's the
team pick.
Yes, okay. Need to just balance the audio level so we're all good. See, been a while since I have to do even think about this kind of stuff. We had Hong Kong, it includes Taiwan, as well as, of course, Korea, as I think I said before. So, as the APAC region, we do have teams which are directly invited from these regions as well. So the directly invited teams are MVP Phoenix as well as the boys Zephyr. Radiant, so they'll be the two teams which will be directly invited to the main competition. I believe there's two other teams which are also meant to be invited to that one. But for all the details, head yourself over to msibeat.com. You can find out the competition there. We've got one team too, which is a bit of a highlight team. We're going through our first round first, and then we'll get through to them. And that's actually a team formerly known as EOT. So it's got J.O. on the boys, who were part of that one, which is a bit of an interesting combination because I think they actually lost their Korean guy, and there's three of them which are over in the Philippines, so it's kind of like a due to visa problems and other things going on. And at the end of the day, it's just like it's up to the admins to deal with it. But we have those guys. They're currently tagged up as Rave, and we'll be jumping into their games pretty much directly after this. So So let's look at our draft. For guys out there who are tuning in, we're not gonna go full depth. We're not going to go like full depth as far as like mind-boggling, blowing your kind of like thing. What we're doing is a bit of a newbie live stream. We're going to look at the very, very basics about the way you assemble the teams and everything else. And what I have learned, because like for those out there that don't really realize, when I do solo casting, in-depth like analysis really isn't my thing. I'm all like, oh, is this guy right to deliver this morning? Oh my god, it's a TI4 combo! That's kind of like not me, actually. I don't do that anymore. I throttle myself a little bit more. We get the Skywrath as well as Void, we get the Tarnet being banned out. These guys are actually sticking very much to the playbook of Dota 2. Taking out the Doom, taking out the Brewmaster, taking out the Lycan. Three almost like full-on bans. Remember, I did an AMA yesterday, and some guy asked me like, what would I change? And I'm like, I would like to move away from these strength-based heroes that can stall the game up through the entire mid-game and then win with one push in the late game. Brewmaster's kind of like a bit of the opposite of that one. I kind of feel like he tails off in the later portion of the game, but in the early portion of the game, into that mid-game, he hits like a really big truck, and he allows those other heroes to just get to the later portion of the game. So that's the reason why I'm a bit of a brew hater. And Pretty Donut, they've actually gone with the classic combo. So there's Faceless Void, Tidehunter, as well as Skywrath Mage. It's a lot of teamfight control. Tide, obviously, he's not going to walk in there and anchor smash in the middle of the corner. That's not what he's there for. What they're looking for is the double and probably almost like tag team control you get from both the two ultimates of Ravage of Tidehunter, as well as the Cronus here from Faceless Void. Now, Skywrath Mage comes into a different area. Skywrath Mage is a great lane winner very early on. He's got a very low nuke. That's this little guy right here, the Arcane Bolt. So we can just spam it out. It costs him 70 mana. I think it's about like a quarter of his mana pool or something like that. And all he's got to do is like bring two or three clarities, and he's good to go on an off lane. And he can normally zone at anyone, including a Tidehunter. So you imagine if you're zoning at a Tidehunter who, like, with Stout Shield and Kraken Shell is a pretty tanky kind of guy. If Skywrath Mage can do that, you have to understand what's he going to do to a different off laner. So I'm interested see how Kirby's going to try and handle that kind of harassment on the lane, because more than likely, Pretty Donuts is going to be there going, well, Skywrath Mage is on top lane. That's going to give Faceless Void a lot of space to Fruity Farm. They can't directly contest against that unless they go all in on it. And they're not going to go all in when you're running an Enigma. Enigma on lane just hasn't seemed to work. There was a time when you could dabble with him in the middle lane, but it had to be a very surprise pick, and you had to be very confident in your pick. Most of the time, we see Enigma inside the jungle. In fact, like 99.99999 recurring, of course, percent of the time, we'll see Enigma inside the jungle, and that means farming, that means safe lane farmer,
10 seconds
and that means protection. So Earthshaker does offer a level of protection. Earthshaker also been tag-teamed in by a couple of the American teams as far as a core. I saw Quotever actually probably run the best core Earthshaker of the entire international. So I don't know if Team Kirby's just feeling confident enough to do such a thing. It's a very, very risky kind of pickup because you can easily lose your lane. And it's very difficult sometimes if you can't, like, you need to get like a very quick blink dagger and transition into being like this big power hitter. So you need to rotate and have confidence to rotate and continuously rotate. It's not like the, well, we got one kill with the Earthshaker, now we just like lay off him a little bit. No, the Earthshaker is always going to be there adding pressure on the lanes, and you're still going to have a semi-carry to follow up. Now, they do have that in the hands of the Viper, and they will, I'm not going to say have it in the hands of the Enigma, but they have someone that can add that early game pressure you're searching for while the Earthshaker is making it in the space. So that's potentially what could happen if Earthshaker's going to go carry. For this game, though, we will assume this is going to be a support Earthshaker, which means jungle Enigma as well as core Viper. Viper can go onto any of the lanes. He should have, well, he'll have trouble up against a Skywrath on the top lane, but you can run him on the mid or you can run him on the bottom. Either way, it won't really mind. Look for the early, well, then again, you could get the early mech over on Viper, but you're also running an Enigma. So if you want to try and rush a BKB and Blink Dagger, then yes, mech for the Viper. And you kind of really do want to have the mech over on the Viper, just because it's this, like, wonderful stay ability.
Radiant team.
Ooh, I'm liking Pretty Donuts combos. I'm really, really liking their combos here. They are definitely taking a leaf out of a lot of teams' books, because this is not a new combo. This is definitely not a new combination. Witch Doctor, really good in the lanes as well, bouncing on the mat, on the cask, the paralyzing cask. Gonna make difficult times for the Earthshaker or the Enigma, and try and swap these conversions of the cask and keep doing its work. Well, at least maybe you can avoid the heroes, but you're still gonna have that cask bouncing around the entire time. And it gives a lot of healing power to the back of Pretty Donuts, so when they want to push early, they can do so. They are still, however, missing a really good pusher. They got some great team fight control, and the pickoff is even better. Like, you got Skywrath Mage dropping the Mystic Flare, and you got Witch Doctor putting down the ward. So once this, this Death Ward drops, anyone who's inside that black hole, inside the Faceless Void Chrono, is dead. And that's a ballsy pick. That is a really, really ballsy pick. When you get a Faceless Void up against you, any high movable heroes, either you can be fantastic and jump away before they're able to hit their combination.
10 seconds remaining.
This is like with Puck coming in for a Rift and Dreamcall kind of controller.
This is
Faceless Void Chrono. This is Enigma Black Hole. If you're fast enough, maybe you can evade it. If you don't, you're dead. Because you're a high maneuverable hero. That means you're not a big tanky guy like the guy that just got banned out, the Centaur. And the Centaur sits there going, okay, now you can hit me. I'm inside your Chrono. What are you going to do about me? Like, if you had DK, if you had like a Trinket protected with living armor, then maybe you'd be able to survive through the initial hit. As you see now, the Puck being banned out by Kirby's because they're worried about another controlling hero. Would have been a great one for the mid as well. Another team fight controlling hero would have been fine for Pretty Donut, but they'll remove him out. They need a silent, like, and then again, like, okay, Faceless Void is only one part of it. You got a Skywrath Mage. This guy can seal the Storm Spirit straight away. Like, there's no animation cast time on that Ancient Seal. So the second he does that, Storm Spirit is literally caught, unable to move. It's almost like playing stuck in the mud. Wait for someone to go through your legs and then maybe you can move, but then again, you're going to get attacked straight away anyway. So you're going to get, yeah. I'm really, really concerned for the Storm pick. This Storm pick for me almost has to be a safe lane Storm Spirit and build into a very early BKB, almost before the Orchid, or else he'll get nothing done. But then again, if he builds a BKB, Void can still control him. And we get a Queen of Pain, an ET. Okay, I have a real concern right now for Kirby's lineup. And the primary reason behind my concern is the more that I look at this lineup, the more I worry it's going to take way too long to get online. The great thing about the lineup coming out from Pretty Donut, okay, Faces of Void is going to take some time to come online. Now, with the recent changes, I say recent, like months ago, changes that came to the Tidehunter, even with Anchor Smash and Kraken Shell at level 2 he hits, he can do offlane with no problems whatsoever. Skywrath Mage, great from early levels. Witch Doctor, also pretty damn good. Getting to level 2, level 3 is a lot more effective. Queen of Pain, she kind of has like that magic depending on how you build, level 7, level 8. But even by level 3, you're able to have the 2 points up in the Shadow Strike. This, of course, does push you back to level 8 before you can have your entire nukes up and running. But you're able to have a Queen of Pain who can zone you out of lanes. And that in itself is a really, really scary thought. If I was in the hands here, like in the position of Kirby's. They could easily get snapped back. And I like this movement as well from PDDT. Like, you look at them and they go, okay, they're running an Enigma. What should we be doing? We should be going into the enemy jungle and just warding the crap out of it. And they're bringing down 4 observer wards, 4 sentry wards on the back of the emergency couple. I love his name. And they've actually split up the observer wards between both Caffeine as well as Lemon Cat. So that's the Tidehunter as well as the Skywrath Mage. And the line's being drawn out here. Now, I'm actually trying to work out if that's meant to be the Enigma color or not. Enigma is hanging back at the base. This is the wisest thing in the world that he should be doing right now. But at the same time, because the level 1 fight's too weak for Kirby's. If they took a level 1 fight, they'll be forced to actually put Nalaphus on the Enigma or Midnight Pulse instead of having the Demonic Conversions. Earthshaker, well, he'll get Fissure anyway, and the Viper wouldn't really change much. ET would get Spirit, nothing would change there. And the Storm Spirit would have to get Static Remnant. So, nothing would really change there. But you hear those abilities just sound off, and you realize, what would that be like up against Kask, up against a Jumping Slow, up against Queen of Pain, who for some reason leveled up Blink as the first level. I'll get back to this in a moment. But you got Skywrath Mage, which with some really great harassment from range. Same with the Gush. The potential for early game kills is just so much higher for the Dire side. So I was enjoying that lineup. They're a little bit late getting back into the lane, however. As you're seeing now, Faces Void was unable to get this block off on the top lane. So the top lane creep wave has already managed to hit already. And this means that he get with a good block on the top lane, the ET is going to get some free experience here. And he's already got a nice ward just sitting up on this top lane too. So it's going to be watching to see what Lemon Cat's going to be up to. So he shouldn't die to any form of gank right now. In fact, the highest potential kill is technically here on the bottom lane. And that's just because Urshik, a Fissure block, could potentially just win this lane hands down. Guys who are tuning in as well, can you spam me some messages over on my Twitter at Toby1Dota. I do have a chat, but it looks like Captain Mansour is the only person who is inside the chat right now. So yeah, just spam me over there and make sure the live stream is kind of going okay. We are running 720p 30 frames per second in accordance with Azubu, as that's what they required us to do. So we'll look a little different to most of the other joint data streams that we do run. But yeah, let me know. Hopefully everything's going nice and smooth for you at home. And we won't miss first blood. Yeah, but I want to kind of go back to what Donut did here in the middle lane. Now, he went Blink first level. The ability to jump in there. Oh, it looks like Swadini is also over there in the chat. So yeah, as far as the Queen of Pain goes, in the normal early levels for a Queen of Pain, yeah, we're right. We're actually taking this to like newbie level as far as builds go. Okay, you got Blink. What is technically going to come your way? If you're really worried about a Fissure hitting you hard early on, then you just leave an unspent skill point. The primary thing you're searching for is high levels up in the Scream of Pain. Maybe just one level over in the Shadow Strike, unless you want to try and win the lanes hands down. And technically, he could have tried to do that with an early Null Talisman rush coming out from Lily as the Storm Spirit. It would have been potential, like enough potential just to force Lily out of this lane. Make him waste his mana and make him basically burn through a lot of his life points. And he could do that with the Shadow Strike. But your primary thing you're working towards is your burst damage. So this burst damage comes from your Scream of Pain. Now, you got to be a little bit careful about how much you level, like, how much, yeah, no, not how much you level it out, but just what your mana pool is going to be, because by the time you hit your Sonic Wave, costs you about 2, it does, exactly, no, about it, okay, all Donut, they can't reach him, we can't bring him in range of that Static Remnant again, so Donut will be fine, but he really needs to finish up that bottle of his. He's only 7 for 1 up against a 13 for 7, that Static Remnant farming has actually been quite effective for the Storm Spirit. Yeah, but the amount of pool you're basically searching for. He's got 481 right now. So you think 120 worth for the Scream of Pain, 250 as far as the Sonic Wave goes, and if you use Blink or the Shadow Strike, you basically can't do a full combination. And this is what they're searching for right now. Okay, Lily. Okay, Bouncing Cask, as well as the gank coming in from Lemon Cat. And that's going to be Lily going down here in the middle lane. I like the early point of Malediction. It's not really required. Mainly because, well, Voodoo Rest Erasure will normally do something more for the lane. But he won the early point, and I won't go against it. But that's a nice little rotation kill coming in there. Witch Doctor with the early money as well. And already with the Flying Courier up and running means we're going to see some early arcane boots over on this Witch Doctor. Which means they open up for as far as like rotation goes. Oh, I like that jump with the concussive shot, with the orb as well. It's just a very simple rotation. There's your Malifus. And, well, actually one more attack, and I think that's enough to get the kill. Yep, you should pop from that. Yep. There it is. Witch Doctor claiming the kill up on top lane.
Stick a bone in it.
And that will be energy booster. Yeah, you see him. He wants the arcane boost straight away. This allows Faceless Void to be very over-aggressive with this jump. Faceless Void, not a man that needs a lot of mana. And just having 100 mana, like, instant regeneration. It's just going to be perfect for him. And also for Sky Wrath Mage. Sky Wrath Mage kind of, like, nerfed himself early on. They bought a lot of sentry wards. And this was in an attempt to slow down the Enigma. You'll notice though, for Enigma, all the camps are open back up again. He's also managed to find four levels inside the jungle. Enigma's one of these heroes that you only require one, maybe two camps, and you're still able to, in like the first 3 to 4 minutes, get a good ratio of farm. That's not the phrasing I'm searching for. Get a good rate of farm. Not ratio, rate. So the Enigma's already doing pretty damn well. So for the two kills which PDTT got, PTDT, yeah, I think, I don't know if I said that right before. Yeah, with the two rotation kills they've got, now that's nice, but what does it really change? As far as your levels go, your Skywrath is still severely underleveled. It's about to hit level 3. At the same time, your Tidehunter, he's hit 3.5 levels, but your Elder Titan, okay, he's still sitting about, he's sitting at the same. So, things are kind of like leveling themselves up a little bit, but I'm going to feel like when I bring this Golgrath up, okay, that's not what I was expecting it to be. I knew the advantage would be the way of Kirby's just because of the Enigma, but I was expecting it to be this high. Now, Donut's on the hunt here. If he wants to, we can kill off the Earthshaker. Because Earthshaker still only got one stun. He'll walk past, well, it's his own Observer Ward, so he knew where the camp was being pulled. But if he's coming down for a kill on the Viper, this will never work. The rotations come too early. Even with the Null Talisman, you can see after one blink, he can Shadow Strike, Scream, Sonic Wave, and then that's it. There's no extra chase after that point. So it's going to be very, very difficult for Donut to ensure any kind of kill on the lane. It kind of feels like, as long as he doesn't lose his lane, it's okay, but at the same time, he lost his lane. 16-3 up against a 25-9. Donut is definitely well behind. Even with that kill that happened over on the Storm Spirit, it's not that crippling for the Storm, because now he's level 6, so he shouldn't get killed off. And this Queen of Pain isn't getting anywhere near an Orchid. Regeneration runes even be stolen by Enigmas here. The fish is just a smack down it around. They're trying to come up and gank this Elder Titan again. And this is really the weak point of the Kirby lineup. The Elder Titan is one of these heroes that takes way too long to really come online. We're not seeing an early Sol Ring. Void's now going to jump. Pops the Chrono. We've got Malifus. I really got to call this correctly. It's Maledict. But Elder Titan, okay, he's trying to get the stomp off. But the Bounce Cask is too much. It's actually a really lethal combination. I'm liking this. I'm really, like, you know the Witch Doctor's already going to hurt pretty hard, but just 1 point up in Maledict, it seems very, very small, but the bonus damage as well as damage, like, tick itself really is effective when you want to ensure these extra kills. And I made sure the Faceless Void Chrono was going to be 100% successful too. I'm glad too that the chat over here in Azubio is being rather noob friendly. So shout out to the guys over there. I think it's Skeet who's asking right now, and the Capamancer who's helping him out. An edumacation place. How's Caffeine doing on the bottom lane? 3 points anchor smash and the 2 points over in the Kraken shell. He's got a little bit of an anchor of a ancient stack going, so that's gonna be some nice farm for him. They're trying to set up a gank here for middle lane. Now at nighttime, this is a lot easier to set up. But they need to have vision of the high ground. And that's why, well, I don't know if this Observer Ward really, yeah, it doesn't reach properly. It's way too far back, in fact. And Enigma, well, actually, it's Earthshaker, sorry, dying at the moment. They need one more attack. There it is. And they actually get two of them. And both of them go up the hill. I was noticing Enigma was dropping low on life, but it looks like he was just popping his soul ring. Top lane, ET's been out for too long. He said, look at this, his four hero movement. This is classic Korean Dota. Elder Titan, whoa, 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 whoa. Donut, restraint, man. Ooh, restraint. You don't buy the lady three bushels of flowers on the first date. You'll ease yourself into it. They let up the sonic wave, he wanted to get a kill. It might have been because he was worried about the TP support that was coming in by the Earthshaker. One Fissure maybe could have split them up a lot, but it's an Elder Titan. He doesn't have an escape mechanism.
Dire's middle tower is under attack. Radiant's top tower is under attack.
I'm getting his name wrong. My bad. Sorry, Kappa.
Dire's structures are fortified.
Top lane movement. It's going to be the ET as well as... Oh, Chrono already. Where is that Malice? And she seals up the Earthshaker. So there's no Fissure support. With the Scream damage, they bring down one. They can move over if they know... Yeah, the pings are coming out. But that's coming out from the Earthshaker. Lemon Cat's so low on life. You can see him. He was holding his Fissure. I think that was actually a kill there. If he threw it, it could have been a kill. Kirby's wasn't going to bring any kind of support. However, they're looking for a trade-off. So they lose the hero. It's up on top lane for a tier 1 tower in mid. Now... Considering PDDT are on the Dire side, losing their tier 1 tower is never a great thing because it's their easy TP support in, so they can instantly counter up against Roshan. At the same time, though, with Kirby's losing off their heroes and more kills coming in, we've got actually two kills now over from the Queen of Pain. This is going to be the co-op gaining a lot of momentum early on, which means just setting up some good wards means they can fight if Kirby's ever tries to come and contest up their Roshan attempt. And you've still got Chrono, and you're still going to have the Death Ward coming out there for Emergency Couple. Not to mention, Skywrath Mage is approaching his level 6. And what are you really getting in return? Like, I'm still looking at a level 4 Earthshaker, who's only now just to forward up his boots. But looks like they're going to smoke gank. Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. Too far up there, Enigma. Don't commit! The black hole! It's not going to work for you, man! He's going to be able to get himself out of here, the Ravage! Okay. I actually wasn't expecting... I thought Queen of Pain was going to get out of that one. With a couple of stick charges up his sleeve, all she had to do was just wait out the hole and then blink herself away to safety. That's all that was really required. But he committed the black hole and thought maybe the conversion damage would be enough. And then the Ravage followed up, but really the kill had already happened. In fact, if we look at it, the Queen of Pain kills off Enigma, then Enigma kills off the Queen of Pain, and then Ravage is cast. So two very big ultimates are down at least. Both the Enigma Black Hole, a little bit longer cooldown than the Tidehunter Ravage.
Denial.
But still. Invisibility. I think they're just ensuring a kill. Now, Witch Doctor. Hello, Storm Spirit. Very quick stun. Now, he does have a Vortex still available. Hey! Now, that's some confidence. That's a dragon back in again. Where's your restoration? Should be triggering this right now. Chrono actually going to protect him. Now, the Maledict is still on top of him. He needs to hit him one more time. One more. There's your orb. There's your concussion shot. There's your stun. And nailed him. It's like Void just trying to pull out the last minute. But the rest of PDDT comes in. And they finish the job. And at least PDDT, their rotation support's really damn good. Kirby's are finding themselves a little bit, like, as far as their draft goes and as far as their direct laning goes, I'm still liking it. Like, you look at the net worth, second to fourth still belongs to Kirby's. And the Queen of Pain hasn't caught up to this one, and for a team with, like, 8 kills, you expect them to be higher. Especially the Tidehunter, but Tidehunter's been involved in nothing. It's just like Caffeine, enjoy the bottom lane. But he's going up against a free-farming Viper. At the same time, he should be okay. All he needs is get us those, like, arcane boosts. He's already got his stout shield. I don't know if he ever wanted... Like, maybe in the early stages, he could have afforded a PMS with the offlane. And just try to get really up in the face of Viper and get the anchor smashes off on him. But to do that, you got to have confidence in yourself to play an aggressive Tidehunter lane. Well, wasn't even looking for that one. Somehow, Enigma killing off the Queen of Pain here in the middle lane. And the TP out while he's at 1/3 of his life points. Storm Spirit, long jump over towards that Witch Doctor. And with a follow-up Fissure from the Earthshaker, they do ensure the kill. So, this is when Kirby's can really start hitting their mark. The Storm's coming online. The Viper is very, very farmed up. He's already walking. See the amount of damage which is just done there to Tide Hunter? Nothing. There's the poison attack coming out from the highest farmed up hero over on Kirby's. And Tide Hunter with his Kraken Shell just shakes the entire thing off.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Now, Faceless Void needs to beat the crap out of this creep wave so he can finally bring down this tier 1 tower. Any TP support coming in would instantly be spotted as well, just because of this observer ward. This has been Radiant's down here for a very, very long time. Back from the days when Skywrath Mage was moving in behind the tier 1 tower searching for the kill, and we had the Earthshaker basically trapped over in the tree line over here. So that's the reason why now it also times out. Bottom lane push is coming in now from Kirby, so looking to force out this bottom tier 1 tower. Should also point out this is a 4 best of 3, you may have noticed up at the very, very top of the screen. This is a 4 best of 3, we're running 2 rounds of best of 3s today. And then the winners of that will qualify themselves directly into the main event, which we are kicking off officially, I believe, in 2 or 3 weeks' time. I know I also hinted towards some other events which are starting up soon. Basically, the end of this month, or end of next month, sorry, is going to be when everything is really back in full swing again. But of course, check out joiner.com for all the details for that one, as well as the MSI Beat It main event, once it does begin. But you can also be watching the Yuzubi live streams, because we got it all sorted out, so it's all embedded. Alright, Ravage is up, Chrono is up, Sonic Wave still on cooldown, but doesn't matter because they got Mystic Flare. So they just need to carry one person out. We've also got our emergency couple coming in, and now they've got an opening. That's a big opening too. Double Ravage. Boy, don't Chrono this! Don't Chrono this, but maybe he's got to the black hole! It's perfect! It's absolutely perfect! Enigma with a triple kill. I think it's perfect. It's for the Kirby's right now. They absorbed the PDDT and just slapped them back. That hole was absolutely perfect. The fissure was even better. And the ET you got is not only his split it down, but his spirit smack bang on top of the Dire side. Sent him packing. Everything until that point, it could have been actually held off, but you're seeing the spike straight away. That's a combo right there from Kirby's. And Tide Hunter, man, he started that right. Once this tier 2 tower is over, I'm going to go back down towards that bottom lane and just talk about what the hell went horribly, horribly wrong. And now they're going to back themselves up. Yeah, they are. The creep wave is just going to get done. Okay, okay, okay. So what happened was, this is what I like to refer to as box of death. What happened was, with a Ravage, you got 2 targets caught out straight away. Now, the Tyler came down, the Queen of Pain also came down, and you found yourself with a Faceless Void also down here in this position. Now, when you've got only 2 targets who are already stunned and already low, you're going to ask yourself the question, are these 2 targets really worth the chrono? Considering you're going to catch out 3 of your own heroes inside the same chrono. So when you got that question poised to you, the right decision was made by Archmage. The right decision was made to not throw out the chrono. What happened wrong there for PDDT was the fact they put all of their heroes into the area where the chrono had to go. So it made his indecision, the follow-up control wasn't there, and then the fissure came in perfectly from the Earthshaker, just down this little region here, and threw it up perfectly. Was able to get a 2-3 hero stun, and from there, it was just a turnaround. The Midnight Pulse, the ET Spirit, and that black hole actually moving over the top of the fissure area and dragging him back in again. It was just a nice turnaround initiate there from Kirby's, capitalizing on the mistake there of PDDT. Oh wow, that's a lot of damage already. Storm Spirit, wonderful control over from the Queen of Pain. Skywrath trying to silence him up with a Mystic Flare too. Storm Spirit in a lot of trouble. Witch Doctor trying to throw the ulti as well. It's a 2-for-1 trade-off here. Storm Spirit and ET going down for the Witch Doctor. Faceless Void actually able to get himself back out and home. That's actually a really good trade for PDDT. Especially that Storm Spirit, he dropped him way too close. For all the confidence of the team fight that you had before, you've still got to give respect over to the damage the Skywrath Mage is capable of pumping out. He's a very high Dire's nuker for an early stage attack of the game. Whenever that Mystic Flare is off cooldown, you cannot move in, especially as a Storm Spirit. We still come down to the same mechanical problem in the draft, which is the fact that Storm Spirit getting silenced completely negates any movement he's doing. And I was actually suggesting an early BKB, just so that control is no longer there, so Queen of Pain's first damage is no longer there. And the only thing you have to really worry about is what would happen when Queen of Pain, when Faceless Void throws down the Chrono. And if his BKB is up before that point. That would be his only primary concern here. But he's going to go in for an Orchid, which means if this Storm Spirit's really going to work, He needs to target Skywrath Mage every single time. The stuns are going to be coming at him no matter what. Until he has his BKB, he will always be worried about that. But his primary concern should be the silence coming out from the Skywrath Mage. Lemon Cat is now target number one for Kirby's at the start of the engagements. And it's not even something like a channeling ability like the Witch Doctor. Oh, Shaker can stop at any time. Because all he's got to do is just throw out the Fissure. And from a very, very long range, which the Fissure is, he'll stop the channeling of that Death Ward. Even through like a Chronosphere, he'll still be able to stop the channeling of the Death Ward. Hello, top lane. Goodbye, top lane. Or should be. Storm Spirit, gonna jump, Fissure, dragging him back to the other side of it too, and now he'll pop the Chrono. Unfortunately for him, he's got his tower in range, so just TP out. Oh, the Malifaux stun! Oh, pooey. In my dreams. PTDT. In some real problems here. Kirby's just rotating perfectly. They're finding kills. That Blink Dagger from Enigma. Very few Enigmas do this early, but this is what I was talking about before. When you have a Viper that's able to rush the mech for your team, it opens up the Enigma to go into other core items for your lineup. And having something like that Blink Dagger, like most people just think of the Enigma as an initiation and control with a black hole. That's all they really consider. But even just the Malifaux stun for moments like that are absolutely perfect. And now they're going to force out the top lane. They've got mechs behind them. The black hole's off cooldown. The Void Chrono is on cooldown. Tynada needs to actually get his mana back up again and get towards that top lane if they want to try and defend this. But with no Chrono, it's very unwise to come in on this. Very, very unwise, especially with that Blink Dagger Enigma. Enigma also, I like it. It looks like Masa has subscribed to the Book of Enigma, the very ancient Chronicles of Enigma, which is not getting a second level up in Black Hole. Because it just costs too much mana. There's no point to it. For the very little bonus damage you get from it, it's not worth it. So it's better just to get the higher points up in Midnight Pulse or stats. Earthshaker, hello. Scouts had a donut. Well, okay, that's a very close Viper. These conversions are actually going to work against him right now because the bounce is going to keep on going out here. Enigma's still waiting for a point to jump in. He knows the Queen of Pain is here. Shadow Strike is not going to make this easy for him. Keeps him low, keeps him slow. So getting into a good position for that Blink Dagger, he has to wait it out. But the push will continue to come. Just conversion army. The other lanes aren't being dumped because PTDT do not have any kind of version of split push. They have to wait it out the old-fashioned way. And the push now does arrive here at the tier 2 tower. But Kirby's heroes are definitely holding back. They're worried about the Void again, and they should be. Like, his Chrono is back off cooldown again. Hilarious thing is, he's nowhere near his team. And this is either through some good D warding, or you gotta look for these inventive wards. Like, we've actually got two sentry wards out here, looking for the Kirby's aggressive observer wards. This is when, like, having an observer ward down in this little region is very, very useful. Or up in some weird position back here. That way you can see the movement of the Dire side, because right now Kirby's, they just don't know what they're up against. Like, we can see it perfectly here, and we know just how far they can force this, because the Void was so far away. But now, the movement's coming. Observer Ward, Scouting out, Donut, Lemon Cat, they're all coming in close. Now, the cask isn't gone, and they actually see him in the tree line. Wonderful Fissure, ET split, now your Enigma. Didn't get the Black Hole off, the Ravage actually jumps over the top of him. It buys a little bit more space than Witch Doctor. A good ult, but now the Black Hole turns it around with the mech charge as well. He holds him here. It's a triple kill for the Storm Spirit. And Caffeine, well, Fissure, Viper Strike. Hey, he's still got the ultimate. Oh, with the ET Spirit, the Tynada is toast. An ultra kill coming out for the Storm Spirit. The tier 2 tower going down as well. And again, they just waited it out. They waited for PTDT to jump themselves in. And then it was a counter initiated. This time, the main player in that game was this Observer Ward. It was also the fact that Mech came off at just the right time from the Viper. The Enigma was looking pretty risky on his life points. And then he got the Black Hole off. Got another 2-3 heroes caught out by PTDT. And when that kind of stuff happens, you know you're going to go down. But those high levels up in the ET, you can't play up against that aura. Don't walk into the Mystic Flare. But now Mystic Flare's on cooldown. They may consider just forcing this a little bit further. Now there goes your mech charge. Just look at the army conversions here. And they're giving you a little respect. I don't really feel like they needed to do that. But at the same time, they're not having to risk anything. They just got the Blink Dagger finished on the Earthshaker as well. So if they can keep this a secret from all the Dire Observer Wards, as I actually look across the map, and Dire Observer wards are few and far between. In fact, all I'm seeing is two sentry wards on the map. I don't see a single observer ward from them on the map. And now with the lineup from Kirby's, I know I was very skeptical about their lineup very early on. The rotating gangs from PTDT. PTDT. Radiant. I didn't get the name right when I say it quickly. Denied. I don't know. The cold has hit the head. By the way, BKB, out of stash, out of stash. Just picked up a point booster. Wait, so we're looking at a an Aghanim Scepter upgraded black hole while he's leaving his BKB all the way back at base. Please, Enigma, pick up your BKB. I don't want to say drop a TP scroll, because right now I kind of like having a TP scroll on you. But here you need that BKB. There's still too many stuns which could screw around with you. I like too the fact that his black hole in the last fight, he got about maybe through 2 seconds of the channel of the Witch Doctor ultimate, and then it was his black hole that cancelled that. So that's where all the damage just ended up. There we go. He actually did drop the TP scroll. Now, this is always a dangerous kind of thing to do, just because you, if you get a split push and like if there's a fight that breaks out in the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane and you're on the wrong side, or like this, he's gonna fissure and actually break the smoke. Boy, oh, don't commit Chrono, don't commit Chrono. I don't know if you can really do this because the Stomp's gonna be there. Malivison as well. So Witch Doctor was caught in the middle of that. Echo Slam will go. He's looking for another Totem Stomp with the ET Splitter. Oh, that's gonna be bad. Maybe there'll be no, there's even a black hole available. There's 4 heroes on the sidelines, 5 heroes on the sidelines. The BKBs protect them all. The Void Chrono called out one hero, and the Urshik has still got almost his entire combination off. He really didn't care at that point. He really, really didn't care. The Ravage went, but the funny enough, when the Ravage triggered, both the Viper as well as the Enigma were inside their BKBs. So the Ravage effect was very, very minimal. This is why I was talking about Lily getting an early BKB because, instead of like the Orchid, because then you're going to have that immunity and you go, okay, Tired Ravage, what you got? Gyros Mage, what you got? Witch Doctor? Well, I suppose you got physical, but still, what you got? Tower is under attack. And the answer is nothing right now. First, Kirby's just going to, yeah, they're shooting up the advantage on both graphs. They have this game firmly in the bag right now. If they lose this, they're going to lose it by making a poor decision going uphill. That's the only way they'll lose this. Right now, they should go in and take Roshan. Chrono's on cooldown. Ravage is on cooldown. They still have Black Hole. They don't have Echo Slam, but that's okay. Radiant's top tower, they have more than enough as long as their BKBs are up and running. And Viper, look at his money too. 3.4k gold over on this Viper. There's your fresh 10-second BKB over in the Storm Spirit, 25 minutes in. And PTDT are coming down to try and contest this. They've got to get this timing absolutely perfect. And already getting scattered out. The ET Spirit is stopping Caffeine from getting in. And Roshan's down. They're too late. Now Enigma. Woohoo! I was looking for a fissure. That would have been enough. Like, if he just fissured up then, caught the Witch Doctor, Blink Out from Enigma would have caught out the Witch Doctor as well with Malifice. And have themselves a kill. The main problem for Kirby's is their creep wave isn't really with them at the moment. And we'll see Lily just head towards the top lane. He's a man charged with the Aegis the Immortal. It's kind of fair enough too. At this point, Viper can't really be killed. And I'm interested to see what next item he's also going to go into. This is actually one of these games where a butterfly will be a really effective next item. Mainly because you've got no hexes on the opposite team. So there's nothing to remove the evasion from the Viper. His other option is... actually, I don't know if Heaven's Halberd will be the best option, considering the Void is about to finish up the BKB. And really, Halberd's not really that great. Yeah, I actually kind of still stick with my initial thing, which is the Butterfly. He can go Mantra as well, there's a lot of options. While the Enigma, he's going to finish his full Aghanim Scepter. In like 3,000 gold. Oh yeah, that's the other obvious freaking thing for Viper. He can actually buy a full Aghanim Scepter right now. But the courier's coming back with actually no point booster Radiant's on it. Bottom tower, so I assume not going to go for that. Top lane push in, maybe you won't even have time Dyer's to. Focus on the range racks. Attack. They force out the fortification Dyer's already. And the fortified. ET Spirit just has a bit of a wander Radiant's around. So we'll see the Witch Doctor a little bit further back. Already PTDT. I prepared their sentry wards in case there's any kind of extra vision, but the range ranks is taken. They can move down a little bit further. Bouncing Cast is trying to get rid of a little bit of the creep wave, but with the army of conversions which can be made, they're so easy to force it out. Void, Chrono, he caught two this time. ET, as well as the Enigma, the Blink Up, Skywrath Mage, and your Ravage. They're going to bring down this Enigma, or can they? Yeah, they can. But how much are they going to lose with this? Witch Doctor still channeling the full ultimate out over on top of this fight. Remember, it is going to be that BKB protection. And I think he's just too big now. There's 15-1 charge still available on this Viper. So he gets the kill on the Witch Doctor. There's still a lot of damage being done at the back end of this play, but with already the amount of farm that's behind him, Storm Spirit with the Aegis protection, long jump in, and the Haste Rune to be triggered after his Aegis Immortal is gone. This is GG. They're going to lose the top racks. They may have to rotate all the way in towards the mid already. And yeah, they just call it, and rightly so. They weren't going to win any more fights. They lost that one pretty hard. And after losing that top racks, it was just going to be a matter of time. It would have been a waiting game until Kirby took a secondary racks and pushed through and then forced out the throne down. Like, that's all they would have really been waiting for. So GG for game number one for the MSI Beat It APAC Open Qualifier. Let's try and find out who are going to be the teams to join Zephyr as well as MVP Phoenix. I've already been invited, and for all the details, head yourself over to msibeatit.com. You can find the details for the competition over there. In the meantime, we'll be having ourselves a short break, and we'll see you back here on the Jordan live stream in just a couple of moments.